Je veux prêcher en anglais, désolé. Je veux en anglais, en français, mais beaucoup plus en anglais. Amen. Ok. Ok. Father God, I bring myself before you, Lord. Use me for your glory, your Lord. Let not be my word, but let it be every word that comes from you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Ok. We are going to read from the book of 1 Kings. Enfin, c'est Premier Roi, chapitre 17. Okay, so, 1 Kings. Et je commence à le verset 8. 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 8. Okay. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, Arise, go to Zarephath, which belonged to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. So he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, indeed, a widow was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, Please, bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, Please, bring me morsel of bread in your hands. So he said, As the Lord your God, so she said, As the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare for it myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. And Elijah said to her, Do not fear, go and do as you have said, but make a small cake from it first. Amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. When I was reading these verses, the Holy Spirit led in my spirit that at times, the small thing that we have, we take for granted. In this story, we have a widow. Now, I want us to take into concept. We have a widow that has a child. And she in a land where there is drought, there's nothing to eat. And we have this man of God that came out of nowhere. She has never met him. She has never seen him. And the man of God asked her, I am hungry. Get me something to eat. And the woman answered him and said, Man of God, I have nothing. All I have is this flour and oil. But it was for me and my children. Now, at times, we are in a situation that God asks you to give something. And you say, Lord, if I give you what I do not have, I will be left with nothing. And God say, I know that you don't have much, but obey my word. Do as I've asked you to do. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what God has asked you to do. And you say, Lord, I don't have the finance. The little that I have is to pay my rent. And but God tell you, I want to take that money and go give to the orphanage. I want to take that money and go bless someone. But when you look at your situation, it's impossible. But the thing about God, he steps in when impossibility is involved. God will never step in when you can do it yourself. That is why he's God. Hallelujah. So God comes in when your strength can no longer hold you. God comes in when your finance can no longer keep you. Hallelujah. That is what is a God of impossibility. This woman only had a jar of oil and flour. Elijah said, I know your situation. I know you have only your son. But if you obey and do according to my will, understand that God will bless you. I was reading the passage. Obedience attracts the supernatural. And disobedience take you away from the grace of God. Hallelujah. And when you look at the book of Exodus, the reason why the children of God remain in the wilderness, because why? They were disobedient. Many a time, children of God, we walk in disobedience because we try to calculate. We say, Lord, if I give this amount of money, I will not pay my rent. But Lord, if I do what you ask for me to do, I will not be able to please my fellow. But understand this, when you walk in obedience, you are going to offend some people. Because I believe if this woman went and told her son, my son, I have this little thing, but this man of God that I don't know where he come from wants me to feed him. The son will say, Mom, don't do it. Don't feed him. Feed me first and let's eat first. And if you have, let's give him. Understand, obedience will go against scientist view. Obedience will go against lawyer views. Your lawyer will tell you that you have to put your hand on your visa, and you will say, no, my God has not told me to do it. I'm going to wait upon the Lord. Lord will say, listen, you have a timeline. If you don't do it now, you might miss your opportunity. And you say, no, God has told me to wait. The reason why it's important for us to wait and to do according to the will of God, because God is not a man. Men learn to calculate. Men learn to look at what the science say, what the doctor are saying. But when this woman decided to say, I'm not going to feed myself first. Listen, I am a mother myself. If someone come and tell me I should not feed my children, I would tell them, be quiet. My children are my priority. But this woman, over the Bible said that God has prepared a woman. So automatically, God has already prepared the heart of this woman. Hence why she did not argue and she did not debate with Elijah. So I pray that God will prepare our heart before it's set up for assignment. That God will put our mind, our spirit in a way that when God will speak to us, we will not be able, we will not have the opportunity to question. Hallelujah. So, amen. Thank you, Jesus. So, preparation is key. Many a time, I see people, they say, God has called me to do the work of God. I say, hold on. Before you go into the altar and do the work of God, you have to be prepared. And not just financially, but also emotionally and spiritually. Because during the word of God, come a lot of tribulation, come a lot of attack, come a lot of rejection. And if you're not ready mentally and spiritually to do the assignment, my brother, my sister, you are going to fall down. This we have a generation, we have young people now, like myself, that are going up to do the work of God without the preparation. You have to go. And King David had to be in the wilderness. On the wilderness, that's what you learn about the Holy Spirit. That is where we see the true ministry of King David. Because King David had received a revelation that he was not able to receive when he was a shepherd boy. But it was when he was going through the wind that God himself revealed his grace, his power. Through King David. So right now, you might be in your time of preparation. Do not despair and do not question what God is doing. Because God knows you might need patience. God knows you might need humility. God knows that you might need finance. Hence why he said, let me prepare your heart. Let me prepare you mentally. Let me do what I need to do with you right now. So when the time comes, when Elijah comes and tell you what to do, you will be ready to do exactly what God has put in your spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And now let me look at the life of Moses. Now we have Moses. Moses, like me, he was a stutter. He was someone that didn't have much confidence. When God spoke to him, God said, Moses, I'm going to ask you to go and set my children free. And Moses said, God, why would you use someone like me? I am not worthy. Bear in mind, I am a murderer. And these people already hate me. You are asking me to go to a place that I might be killed. And God say, I am sending you. When God sends you and God makes a way, he say, I will go before you. I will pave the way for you. I will make a way where there seems to be no way. So therefore, when I speak to you, when I tell you go, don't question me. Don't ask me how or who. Just understand that the Lord your God has gone before you and he's going to be with you. So Moses said, okay, God, I'm going to go, but I have nothing. God said, what you have in your hands? My question to you is that, what do you have in your hands right now? It might be just your faith. It might be just belief. Whatever it is you have, God is saying that I can use it for my glory. Moses said, all I have is my staff. And I say, Lord, all I have is my obedience. I have nothing else, but I'm willing to obey. And I know as I obey you, and as I do your will, you will do the extraordinary. Hallelujah. Do not despise the small beginning. Do not despise the small thing you have right now. God is saying, I'm able to use that small thing into something great. It's full of stuff that Moses was able to do all this miracle. It wasn't full of a big car or a big mansion. It was just something small as a staff. You may have something very small right now. Or you know a young person that has some. I always tell my followers, listen, you don't have to wait and to open a church to do the will of God. It can start small as sharing verses. It can start small and telling people that Jesus Christ is alive. Jesus Christ is real. Give your life to Christ. Why do you wait until you have a church to start speaking about God? Now, even when you look at the book of Luke, Luke chapter 16, verse 10, he say, he is faithful in what is least, is faithful also in much. So God is not going to give you £1 million when he cannot trust you with £10.
Some of us, we pray and say, God, use me mightily. Use me upon nation. But you cannot even kill the witch in your small village. But you want God to use you among nation. Hallelujah. So God's the little I have given you right now, what are you doing with it? We are believing that we are going to fly around east, west, south. But God said, in your neighborhood, in your community, I'm going to test you. I want to see what you do in your own family. I want to see what you do within your friend. How much do you talk about me? How much do you boast about me? How much do you stand firm in the faith? Because if you stand firm in the faith with a small thing, I will be confident to give you the great thing. And he said, and he who is unjust in what is least is also unjust in much. So if you cannot be faithful with a small thing, don't expect God to give you something great. Don't expect God to give you something like a nation ministry, because already you cannot even shake your little neighborhood. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous moment, he will commit to you trust in the three riches. Amen. Hallelujah. So we also learn faithfulness. Faithfulness brings glory. Hallelujah. You have to be faithful unto the will of God, despite how you feel, despite your small beginning, despite the persecution. As a child of God, you are going to be persecuted. The minute you give your life to Christ, there are family members that will turn their back on you. Then they will tell you, why are you following this God? Because there's nothing to gain from him. But you must remain faithful. You must remain obedient. You must trust God that he's going to do exactly what he said he's going to do over your life. And when God wants to do something in you, he never shows you the big picture. He always shows the glimpse of it. That is where faith comes in. God will never show you that in 10 years time, you're going to be worldwide. But God will say, follow me. Obey me, do my commandment, walk according to my will, and I will bless you. Bless you can mean anything, but we want things to be done right now. We want to be star, we want to be famous right now, but the things of God takes time. Even Jesus Christ had to wait. Even David, although David was anointed to be a king, David had to sit still and wait until Saul died. David had to sit still and knew that he was a king and go in the wilderness. Imagine someone has called you king and you see someone else ruling over your people. That requires a lot of patience, a lot of humility, a lot of, a lot of leadership. And that is why God took David away. Because God knows that though I've called you a king, you need this skill in order to rule these people. There are stubborn people, there are disobedient people. And if you don't have, this is why Saul could not rule. Because Saul was easy influence. Saul was a people pleaser. He always said, they told me to do it. It's not my fault. It's them. But so God knew that I cannot allow another king come and do this. I have to bring a king of valor. I have to bring a man. I have to bring a leader that is not moved by what people are saying. That is not moved by pressure, but is led by my spirit. So maybe that God has said he's going to use you. And at that place, you see someone else is doing your job. And God said, be still. I know what my son has done. I don't want you to make the same mistake. So allow me to prepare you. Allow me to work in you. Allow me to take your flow and make it into perfection. Hallelujah. I believe last week, a man of God talked about the potter 2 weeks ago. Allow God to mold you. Allow God to shape you. Allow God to turn you into that beautiful vessel so he can pour his oil upon you. If the vessel is broken, no matter amount of oil you put inside, it will not last. If a cup has a hole, even if you pour a whole 1 liter in a 50-milliliter cup, it will not stand. Therefore, you are the vessel of God. Allow him to break, shake, move, reshape again. So when the time comes for God to put that oil upon you, you are ready for the assignment that God has for you. You know that you're ready physically, you're ready financially, you're ready spiritually in every angle. So when the enemy wants to come and strike, you stand firm and say, listen, If God be for me, who can be against me? If God has appointed me, you cannot disappoint me. So therefore, I'm going to stand still. I'm going to believe in every word that God has spoken over my life, and that God said that he will use me to shake nation. He will use me to make the blind man see. He will use me to make the crippled man walk. Therefore, those words alone shall be enough for me, because through the word of God, the world was created, and through the word of God, your life, your destiny can also be changed in Jesus' mighty name. In 15 minutes, amen. 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 Hallelujah.